Which established that the current final functioning model is not correct, and running instead, the atom consisted of a small nucleus, which was very small, and which was positively charged, and that there were what you might call orbiting electrons, which were the negatively charged bits, and that everything else in the atom was simply empty space. All the mass of the atom was contained in the very small central nucleus. And if you wanted some idea of the scale, then if the entire atom were the size of an ordinary room, the nucleus would be the size of a grain of sand. We now know that this central nucleus is in fact made up of protons and neutrons orbiting together within the nucleus. Protons are positively charged, neutrons have no charge, and that begs the question that if protons are positively charged, they ought to repel one another, because light charges repel, and if they repel each other, there shouldn't be a nucleus, because it shouldn't be possible to have two or more protons in a nucleus. But since the nucleus or nuclei are stable, that must be because there is something that is holding them together. Whatever is holding them together is stronger than what's trying to push them apart. And the thing that's holding them together is the strong nuclear force. So we say that the strong nuclear force must be stronger, that's why it's called strong, than the electromagnetic force or the Coulomb force, which is trying to push them apart. And the question for this video is, what is the size of that nucleus? And more accurately, we want to know what is the size of the radius of that nucleus. Well, let's come back to the famous Rutherford experiment, which was performed in the very early 1900s. Rutherford took an alpha source, that is, it was radium-226, and the alphas were targeted at a target which was a very, very thin piece of gold foil. And then on the other side he had a detector, and that detector was on a swivel, so that you could actually move the detector right the way around, you know, almost a full circle, to detect where the alpha particles came off, here, 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 or wherever. The energy of the alpha particles was 4.87 MeV, and these here are alpha particles hitting the gold foil. So what he found was that the overwhelming majority, virtually all of them, just go straight through. And the reason they just go straight through, of course, is that when they hit the atom, for the bulk of the time, there's nothing to hit, because most of the atoms hit. Consequently, the alpha particles just go through the gold atoms, because there's nothing to stop them. But every so often, the alpha particles, which consist of two protons and two neutrons, so it's two positively charged particles, would come close to the gold nucleus. And the gold nucleus consists of 79 positively charged protons. And when that happens, you would get the Coulomb law of repulsion, and that would cause the alpha particles to deflect. So consequently, you would find that alpha particles would be coming off. But not many. Indeed, what Rutherford found was that some of the alpha particles sort of seemed to bounce back. So strong was the Coulomb force of repulsion. Now, what Rutherford considered was in this situation here, let's say that this is the gold nucleus with 79 protons. He considered the alpha particle that was heading straight for that gold nucleus. So the most alpha particles will go way to the side of the nucleus and hardly be influenced at all. They'll just go straight through an empty atom and down the other side. But what about the alpha particle that is on a collision course for the nucleus? Well, you've got an alpha particle which consists of two positively charged protons coming towards a nucleus which consists of 79 positively charged protons. There is therefore going to be a force between the two, and that force is equal to a constant times the charge on one particle, that's the alpha particle, times the charge on the other particle, that's the gold nucleus, divided by r squared, where r is the So as you get closer, as the distance between them decreases, the force between them will increase. That is a force of repulsion. So essentially, as this alpha particle comes towards the nucleus, it will be slowed down by the force of repulsion. And it will be slowed down, says Rutherford, right to the point where at some point it will stop. The force will be so great that it will stop. And then it will turn around and just come back on itself. So the alpha particle heading to the nucleus, says Rutherford, will slow down because there's a force of repulsion bringing it the other way. Eventually it stops and then it gets back. What happens when that occurs? Well, says Rutherford, at this point here it has kinetic energy. And we know what the kinetic energy was, it's 4.87 MeV. And when it gets to this point here where it stopped, it has zero kinetic energy. But of course, kinetic and kinetic energy must be conserved. And so at this point, all the energy must have been converted into potential energy. And the potential energy, or the electric potential energy, is given as Q1, Q2, divided by 4 pi epsilon 0 r, where 1 over 4 pi epsilon 0 is the same as K that I used here. And if you then simply switch these two around, so what you're effectively saying is that the kinetic energy has become the potential energy. So if potential energy equals this term, the kinetic energy must be equal to this term because all the kinetic energy has changed to potential energy. And that means that what you can say is that if you just swap R and kinetic energy around, you get that the radius is equal to Q1, Q2, divided by 4 pi epsilon 0 times the kinetic energy. So we know that, just to give you the value, 1 over 4 pi epsilon 0 is equal to 8.99 times 10 to the 9. There will be units, but let's not worry about those at the moment. So Rutherford's idea, let's just review it again, is that the alpha particle slows down under the force of repulsion between the alpha particle and the gold nucleus. And it stops, and then of course it goes back. At the point at which it stops, all the kinetic energy has been changed into potential energy. So kinetic energy becomes potential energy. The value of potential energy is given by this formula, and therefore kinetic energy equals this formula. If you simply swap over the two terms K and R, you get a term for R, which is, of course, not necessarily the radius of the nucleus. It's simply the distance of closest approach. So I've rewritten the formula, which we just derived, for the radius. And now let's see if we can work out what that actually is. Well, Q1 is the charge on the alpha particle. The alpha particle has two protons, so that's 2 times the charge on a proton, which is 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 coulombs, times Q2, which is the charge on the gold nucleus, and that's got 79 protons, so 79 times the charge on a proton, 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19, times. And now we've got the 1 over 4 pi epsilon naught term, which is 8.99 times 10 to the 9. That's all in the numerator. Divided by the kinetic energy. Well, the kinetic energy, remember, was 4.87 MeV. Well, to convert that to EV, you have to multiply by 10 to the 6. And to convert that into joules, you need to multiply by 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19. You'll notice now that one of the 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 terms cancels out. Now, also, that in this rather complicated equation, there are in fact only three terms that are true variables. That is the number of protons, the number of protons in the alpha particle, number of protons in the gold nucleus, and the kinetic energy in MeV of the incoming alpha particle. All the rest in the sense are constants. So what I think is we're going to do this, he quoted this calculation several times, it's not a bad idea. That complex calculation or calculation is fine. Let's just work out what R is in terms of 2 times 79 divided by 4.87 times a constant, where the constant is everything else apart from those 3 terms. And if you work out what that constant is, that is to say, what is 1.6 times 10 to the minus 19 times 8.99 times 10 to the 9 divided by 10 to the 6, you will find that that equals 1.44 times 10 to the minus 15. And the units, which is one of our, of course, anything, is this. So now we can do the full calculation, which is to say 2 times 79 divided by 4.87 times 1.44 times 10 to the minus 15. And that comes to 46 times 10 to the minus 15, which is, or did you prefer, 4.6 times 10 to the minus 14 meters. Now, as I said, that is not the radius of the nucleus. That is simply the distance of the closest approach of that alpha particle heading to the nucleus, which where all the kinetic energy is converted to potential energy. It comes to a stop and then it goes back again. When it comes to a stop, according to this formula, the alpha particle is 4.6 times 10 to the minus 14 meters away from the center.
Thank you.